One of the most prominent names in the burger world of America during the 1950s was Burger Chef, a burger place that spread like wildfire, completely overtaking the fast food competition in America. Today, Burger Chef is a name we are not even familiar with. The question, where did this brand go? From the highest success to the lowest turmoil, here is the story of Burger Chef. Burger Chef actually began with two people patenting a flame broiler from the company they were at. With nothing but a dream, an idea, and each other, Frank and Donald Thomas began Burger Chef in Indianapolis, Indiana, in the romantic spring of 1957. They picked out the name to represent the brand as a more accessible Burger King, and we think even they were not expecting that it would one day rival and overtake Burger King, at least in the 20th century. It was founded on the principle of being a clean, affordable burger joint that you could take the entire family out to, specializing in hamburgers, which need no introduction to any American who was not born yesterday. It actually did have a rather small start, but it would keep consistently climbing the ladder and beating every other fast food joint around. Sticking to the rules you were founded on can do that for a business, and Burger Chef is definitely living proof. In 68, the company they got the patent from bought them out and kept the momentum going with an even faster expansion. By 1972, Burger Chef already had an astounding 1,200 locations across America and a burger they were renowned for, the Burger Chef, with their Super Chef hamburger later being as famous as McDonald's own Quarter Pounder. More than half of America was overrun with Burger Chef branches, as at least 39 states out of 50 had dozens for each state. They were not exactly known for their expansive or versatile menu, but what Burger Chef did, it did really, really well. The taste of their beef burgers resonated with every American who loved the classic meal of a good hamburger, fries, and a shake to end it all on a good note. Sure, other fast food joints like Wendy's did not have that weakness, but they also did not have as unique of a taste, so it was an evened-out deal in most people's eyes. General Foods Corporation, who now owned Burger Chef, had no plans of stopping the moneymaker that the brand had become and attempted to take to the seas next. Their expansion would continue internationally and go on to Australia, and they even got their own mascot, Burger Chef and his trusty sidekick, Jeff. However, despite the charm of the now revamped Burger Chef who had never been doing better, it turned out that people there did prefer diversity in their menus more so than Americans, and so it did not particularly do well. Any good challenger knows how to take criticism and get better because of it, though, and this restaurant aimed to be no different. In the same year, they came out with the Fun Burger, which came with puzzles and different toys, and then they whipped up the Fun Meal, their very first iteration of a classic kids' meal. It had a burger, fries, one drink, and a cookie, all with a small toy. One of the most nostalgic and attractive parts of this meal was the packaging, which would usually chronicle the many adventures of Burger Chef and Jeff and their retinue of trusty friends, like Count Fanburger, Burgerilla, and Cackleburger the Witch. These meals would be filled with different riddles and puzzles, and the idea here was to capture a new market of children mostly, something it was very successful at doing. For a lot of people, the slogan of "there is more to like at Burger Chef" and "nowhere else but Burger Chef" were not just catchy marketing phrases, but sentiments that rang very true in their minds. Really, when you craved a burger, there just was not any place that was doing it like Burger Chef was in the 50s to 80s. Though nowadays people may not remember just how iconic this place used to be, anybody that grew up back then will know the cheesy happiness they gave you for just a few dollars and cherish the memory deeply. At its peak, the burger, fries, and drink combo meal that you could get for 45 cents was their most popular item, and Burger Chef was going all over America from Louisiana and Des Moines to California and New York. In Washington, their light but fulfilling breakfast menu popped off very nicely. Their hamburger was just for 15 cents, with the cheeseburger being only 5 more. Their hot fish sandwiches were also massively popular items, and their milkshakes were not too bad either. With a menu that took quality over quantity to heart, Burger Chef cemented its place in America's history of fast food for a long time ahead. It does beg the question, though. So far, it does not seem like Burger Chef did anything too differently from other fast food players in the industry at the time, So why was this one blessed with all the success in the world? Well, that is because they took quality control a bit too seriously. If a new franchise was about to pop up, then they had to go to Indianapolis and observe literally every step of the process firsthand. That includes catsup dispenser top-ups, employee interviews, and accounting. They even took the people who worked at a branch very seriously, unlike other fast food places that hire teenagers looking to make a quick buck in their summer break. Any employee would be given a personality test, and there was a strict dress code. So on all fronts and accounts, Burger Chef really wanted to set a specific impression, and it took every step possible in order to do that. For grand openings, they would offer free balloons to the kids, so you can already tell that this place really wanted to come off as a family-friendly haven to take your wife and kids out to for a refreshing meal. Plus, the cuisine was something everyone could vibe with at the time. Burger Chef peaked at 1,200 branches in America, a number only McDonald's would surpass with 1,600 during the 1960s. It was a massive chunk of the fast food industry's overall sales, with millions of dollars being raked in at its peak, just for being able to flip and grill a burger better than anybody else on the block could hope to do. They even had a toppings bar that you could go to, and a salad bar where you could customize your order, something that fast food joints were not incorporating too much of back in those times. Actually, a lot of standard practices according to today's fast food scene in America were things that Burger Chef had either first come up with, or it was the first big-name brand to be having those features in their stores. They were also really known for their wide array of burger condiments. A lot of stories for Americans happened at a Burger Chef. It was a popular place to hang out if you were a teenager in high school, and many would-be husbands and wives had their first meeting over a 15C burger. They also had these refillable drinks so you would never run out of a fresh glass of Pepsi or Coke. As you can see, perfecting every part of your craft rather than constantly coming up with new marketing strategies and products can give you much more success. But the fast food industry was a lot different and worked at a much slower pace than it does today. Back then, places could still experiment and try to slowly build a presence without being weeded out by the big dogs of the market. That kind of environment also helped Burger Chef flourish, but we think it would do well in today's world too because of how unique and memorable the taste of each item on the menu was. Unfortunately, things would start to take a turn for the worse. As they say, everybody's luck has to run out sometime, right? Burger Chef could not reach the everlasting status of brands like KFC and McDonald's, which are still flourishing well into today's modern world of 2024, as it would eventually crumble under the weight of both its ambitious, never-ending expansion and to titans like the ones we just mentioned. Burger Chef faced regional competition all across America, and the magic that originally attracted lots of people to the brand was lost when General Foods and Corporation kept trying to make several rebrands to Burger Chef, changing the logo and design, and introducing new layouts for stores that did not work as well as the original. A long story short would be to not fix a clock that is not broken, but we are here for all the juicy bits and details. Burger Chef tried to regain its edge by making partnership deals with brands like Star Wars in a bid to roll out 7 entire new kids' meals, and these meals would feature cardboards that children could assemble droid puppets out of. They even had a C-3PO meal and a TV commercial featuring R2-D2. One starts to wonder how a company that initially rocked the nation with nothing but a simple burger that did not stand out much from the rest now needed partnership deals to keep itself in the conversation with other fast food chains. And this is what happens when you stray away from the core of what draws people to you and what your customer base appreciates you for. The fun meal that was Burger Chef's original kid meal was overtaken by the McDonald's Happy Meal, and they swore up and down that McDonald's had copied the idea from them. They were confident enough in that claim to sue the McGiant and take them to court over it, but they lost that lawsuit and a lot of money was wasted over it too. Plus, it was all a well-timed MI that left Burger Chef on its last legs. Not only was it not making the smartest business decisions out there, but it was also a time where fast food joints were booming across America in what would later be a nationwide explosion in fast food being a common part of people's daily meals and nutrition, especially in middle-class neighborhoods. This meant that there was no worse time to be messing up on the business end of things, as competition everywhere was rising and everyone was trying to put their best foot forward to stay ahead of the rat race. Burger King, which the chef was thought to have surpassed, was also giving it some steep competition. As these companies had much better operational management and customer retention, the kind that Burger Chef could not replicate. To be fair, nobody has managed to climb that mountain yet either, so we do not blame them. In just about 25 to 30 years from the 60s, when it was the only fast food joint that really had that kind of mass appeal, it became a dying brand that was sizzling out rather fast. Remember that brief stint they had abroad over in Australia? When that ended in 1975, it cost the brand $1.3 million, which in today's terms is well over $7 million. That is a pretty hefty sum. Enough to start a brand over 10 times, really. General Foods would continue to make poor business decisions when they sold the company in 1982 to Amasco, which was a Canadian company looking to expand to the United States, for $44 million, and Amasco did not have any plans about doing justice to our beloved chef. They treated the brand horribly and more or less consumed the entire brand to uplift their own shops, using Chef as a way to branch out more Amasco and Hardee's shops in America. Most of the locations for Burger Chef were changed into Hardee's outlets, and the ones that were not, unfortunately, just closed down. River West Brands LLC tried to sue Hardee's, claiming abandonment of the trademark of Burger Chef, but it eventually dropped the petition and paid its lawyers' fees, which would be the last nail in the coffin. Financial loss after loss left the company rather crippled, and with the approach of the 2000s, every other presence in the fast food industry was much better equipped to deal with the waves of change that America's eating patterns were going through. Currently, there are almost no remaining Burger Chef outlets left in America, and the last proper outlet in Tennessee closed down in 1996. That was in Cookeville, and that branch changed ownership and rebranded itself to Pleasers. And that is where this iconic restaurant story ended for a lot of customers, effectively burying the Burger Chef name. Their franchise agreement running out did not help matters at all for the company either, and they did not have enough left in the tank to go for a renewal. It has now been almost 30 years since that happened, which is more than enough time for America to forget, especially in how today's world is one trend today and two more tomorrow. Things move much faster nowadays, and their popularity faded fast enough that when Hardee's tried to pull out the Big Chef burger in a nostalgic cash grab, it did not even do well enough for them to retain it in the Midwest. They did this thrice, in 2001 and 2007, and then once again in 2014. Each time proved that the Burger Chef name was slowly fading out of people's heads and more or less had already faded away. It had 1,200 outlets at its prime, but in the 70s, that number literally halved itself to 650, and General Foods had a hard time trying to sell the company too. You cannot find the taste of a Burger Chef or a Super Chef anymore today anywhere, because all branches are now out of business. The classic Fun Meal, the Works Bar, all of it is now just a memory and a part of the many pages of America's culinary history books. Burger Chef is both a cautionary tale of the risks of greed and working in the fast food industry. It is an encouraging reminder that if you do something right and distinctly enough to stick in people's memory, you can start from nothing and make your way up to being in competition with all the top names in America. When it started out, it really was doing amazingly. It had substance and soul, a taste that people who grew up with Burger Chef still remember even in the 2020s, and affordability. It knew its customer base and what it wanted to be, and it wasted no time in carving that identity. But one conglomerate takeover after the other can cause a company to be left on shaky footing, especially if said multinational companies do not have the same passion and drive for the brand that initially made it so beloved. Still, for what it was and for when it existed, there truly was nowhere else like Burger Chef, and at one point it had everyone sweating with its potential. The fast food industry continuously needs innovation, adaptation to ever-changing tastes, and sustainability, which are three factors that brands like Burger King, McDonald's, Wendy's, Taco Bell, KFC, Pizza Hut, etc. have all nailed. They have these critical necessities down to a science, and it explains a bit of why these companies and brands have managed to last so long. The McDonald's of today is so incredibly different from the McDonald's of Burger Chef's time, and that goes for any other name we just mentioned. Yet Burger King stayed relatively the same, and when it did try to redesign, it strayed too much from the original to the point that loyal fans did not like it, and new ones did not resonate with it, effectively alienating both. That is such a different contrast from how we remember Burger Chef, since most of today's world knows Burger King as a brand that failed and died. But in its heyday, it was known as this no-name joint that eventually managed to give every other fast food place a solid run for their money. It was a comfortable, cozy place that worked great no matter what your reason for getting out that day was. You could just be spending the weekend with your family, you could be out catching up with friends you have not seen, or just spending another Tuesday with ones you see every day, or you could drive by a Burger Chef on a cute date, pick up some takeout for an incredibly reasonable price and go home. Even if that is not how websites and fast food analysts remember it today, that is how it will always stay in our hearts. And that is an opinion still shared by many. Just look at all the "What happened to Burger Chef?" Google searches that pop up. Let us know your thoughts on the story of Burger Chef. If you like the video, make sure to like and subscribe for more historical accounts of vintage America.